Read my lips. I will never go out with you, Trina said as she pushed past me to get to her class. The students close by whispered and smirked as they looked on at my embarrassment. That was a month ago. A lot can happen in a month's time. Hi, my name is Zane. If you want to continue receiving great content, like and subscribe to our channel. Tapping that notification bell helps you to see our stories first. Trina is what we call a plastic, and she's been my crush since high school. She was always well put together, dated the top jock, and, well, on any given occasion, she could be really mean. You may ask, why would you want to be with someone like that? But the heart wants what the heart wants. I'm sure you've liked some questionable people before. One thing I always admired about Trina was that she was a straight-A student. My friends, however, didn't buy it. They thought that something had to be up for her to get all A's all the time in college, since in high school, she had a C average. Every year at Robinsonville College, a fundraiser called a May Fair was hosted. It has games, prizes, and food. Later in the evening, there is a disco with a DJ and students dance the night away. This is my second year at Robinsonville, and the disco last year was awesome. Missing it this year was not an option, especially since I overheard Trina telling her friends that she'll be there. When my friends and I arrived, the disco was in full swing. We paid our fee and went inside. It was jam-packed. My friends and I danced with a few girls from some of our classes until I spotted Trina in the crowd. I walked towards her, but she moved through the crowd quickly. I saw her exit the dance and I pursued her. As she rounded the corner, I had to jog to catch up to her. I was about to call out to her when I noticed she stopped to chat with the dean, Mr. Rivera. I slowly retraced my steps and hid behind the wall and observed. I watched as Mr. Rivera lightly touched Trina's face and how she moved closer to him and held onto his jacket. What is going on between Mr. Rivera and Trina? I mumbled. A faculty member and a student engaging in a relationship never ended well. The faculty member usually lost their job, and the student was expelled. Maybe I can use this to my advantage, I said slyly. I pulled my phone out of my pocket, but just as I was about to record, they walked away. I decided to follow. My eyes lit up when I realized that they were headed towards the dean's office. This is about to get good, I smiled to myself. I waited until I heard the door to the office close before I snuck below the office window. The office had open blinds, which I used to my advantage. I pressed record and I peeked through the blinds to get a better look at what was taking place. It wasn't long before Mr. Rivera and Trina were making out in his office. It was gross. I mean, Mr. Rivera was a young guy and Trina was in her 20s, but still. Achoo! A sneeze escaped before I had a chance to withhold it. Did you hear something? Mr. Rivera asked. Oh, you big scaredy cat, Trina said playfully. Mr. Rivera walked over to the blinds and I was sure that I was caught. Luckily for me, all he did was close the blinds. I snuck out of the office and sighed with relief once I was outside. So that's how Trina has been getting all those A's, I said as I secured my phone in my pocket. Well, Mr. Rivera, there's a new sheriff in town. I hope Trina's ready for the big change. I walked onto campus Monday morning feeling like a brand new person. I had the video on my phone and I emailed it to myself on a few different accounts for safekeeping, as well as downloading it on a thumb drive which was hidden. When I saw Trina, I ran over to meet her. Why, hi there, Trina. How was your weekend? I smiled. Trina scoffed. Wouldn't you like to know? Her friends laughed, but I continued. I take it that meeting you had in the dean's office went well, I smirked. Trina's face turned ghastly white as she fumbled. I don't know what you're talking about. Her friends looked at her, confused. I pulled out my phone. Shall I show you and your friends what I'm talking about? I said as I played with my phone in my fingers. Y'all go ahead, Trina said to her friends. Let me see what this doofus wants. As soon as her friends walked away, she turned to me. Her green eyes looked as though there were flames dancing in them. What do you want? She asked furiously. I showed her the video and then said, I want you to be my girlfriend. You're going to march to Mr. Rivera's office and tell him your little whatever is going on is over. If not, your little video will be the next popular thing on social media. I walked with Trina to the dean's office and waited outside for her. When she exited the office, she gave me a deathly stare, but I shrugged it off. I wanted her to like me for me, but I guess she could pretend to like me until she really started to like me. Now that's over, will you hold my books for me and walk me to class? I asked slyly. Trina was about to make a sarcastic comment when I waved my phone in front of her and said, Trina grumbled, but she took my bag and books and walked me to my class. We got a few looks, but Trina didn't say anything. She dropped me off, I took my stuff, and I kissed her on her cheek. I said, tonight, I'll pick you up at 8 for our first date. Wear something nice. That night when I picked her up at her house, Trina looked stunning. Her green dress really brought out her gorgeous green eyes. I handed her the flowers I bought and she followed me to the car. We cut dinner short when she got a call from her mother saying that there was an emergency at home. I knew that she probably asked her mother to call her during dinner as an escape plan, but I obliged anyway and I dropped her home. I told her I would see her tomorrow at school when she got out of the car. "This is just the beginning," I smiled as I drove off. The next 2 weeks were like a dream come true. I had my own personal assistant. I got Trina to do everything for me, including feeding me in the cafeteria and doing my assignments. I even ordered a large handheld feather fan so that she could fan me while placing grapes in my mouth. The only thing she didn't do was actually bow down and kiss my toes. My friends complimented me on the great job I was doing with Trina. They asked me how I was able to make her change that quickly. I just told them that Trina realized what a great guy I was. I was having a great time till Trina missed a day at school. I didn't mind too much till I realized that one day quickly turned to three. I tried calling and sending her messages, but to no avail. I even threatened to leak the video, but Trina did not respond. After classes one afternoon, I decided to visit Trina at home. Her mother greeted me. Her eyes were puffy and red as though she'd been crying. "Good afternoon, is Trina here?" I asked politely. "Trina is missing. She went to school and never came back. They asked for a ransom of $50,000. They said if we went to the police that we will never see Trina again," her mother cried. I thanked her and told her that if she needed anything, that I would be available to help. That night, I tossed and turned, trying to come to terms with what happened to Trina. I felt awful about how I treated her. Around 11 p.m., my phone rang. It was Trina.
"Zane, hello? Hello?"
Trina asked, her voice shaking. I pushed my covers aside and sat up.
"Trina, where are you?" I asked. "I'm safe. I was able to get away, but I need you to come and get me. Please, don't tell my parents yet. They have been through enough."
"Tell me where you are. I'll come and get you." She gave me the address. I pulled on my sneakers and grabbed my car keys. I jumped in my car and went to the address. I pulled up to the gas station and I saw Trina exit the store. She walked towards the car, ever so often looking over her shoulder.
"Thank you for coming," she said as she threw her arms around me.
"No problem, let's go." While on the way home, someone covered my mouth. Someone was in the back seat of my car. I swerved a bit from the sudden movement and Trina screamed. Luckily, the road was clear. The man said, "Do as I say." He then gave me directions to a location. The man said, "I'm right behind you. Any funny business and both of you will never be seen again." After about 1 hour down a long winding road in the middle of nowhere, I pulled into the parking lot. "Now take your friends there and walk into the building. Go to the top floor. There you'll see a chair and rope. Tie up Missy and wait for my instructions. And don't try anything. Someone is already in the building looking at you," the man instructed. Trina and I reluctantly got out of the car and entered the building. We did as we were told and headed to the top floor. We had to use the stairs. As we began to ascend, I looked behind us and, true to his word, someone was in the building following us. Trina held my hand and I squeezed it.
"Don't worry, we'll be okay,"
I smiled. When we got to the top floor, it was an open space. There was a chair and a rope waiting. I apologized to Trina for tying her up as well as blackmailing her. "I honestly didn't mean for it to go that far. I just wanted you to notice me and give me a shot," I said softly. After tying up Trina, I sat in the room on the floor next to her, wondering what would happen next. A few minutes passed and I got a text on my phone telling me to look at the video I was just sent. When I clicked the play button, the video showed me clips of security footage. Trina walking to my car from the gas station, Trina hugging me, me pulling up to the parking lot of the building we were in with Trina and both of us walking inside. And last but not least, me tying Trina to the chair. All the footage had the same date 3 days ago when Trina allegedly went missing. My jaw dropped. "How is this even possible?" I passed my hand through my hair in frustration. My phone rang. The man said, "Let Trina go, then walk outside 5 minutes after." He hung up once again and I did as I was told. Trina smiled at me before making her way down the stairs. After 5 minutes, I made my way downstairs. Once downstairs, there was another car in the parking lot. A man leaned against the car and Trina stood next to him. By this time, I was very confused. "So, are you going to stop blackmailing my daughter, or should I tell the police that you kidnapped her?" Trina's father said sternly. I was shocked. "I never kidnapped your daughter," I stuttered. "Well, the footage from the security camera, the note which came from the page of one of your books, which, by the way, the police could get a lot of fingerprints off that, and the fact that I just transferred $50,000 to your bank account, just like the kidnapper wanted,
proves that you kidnapped my daughter, the man said forcefully. Trina's father walked up to me, grabbed my collar, and said, The next time you come after my daughter, I will not be as generous as I am now. If you don't delete the video that you have of my daughter, I will start to post all your family secrets. The first thing I will post is why your father went to jail for 5 years as soon as he finished college. Leave my daughter alone. He let me go and I nodded and rubbed my neck. Trina and her father jumped in their car and drove away, leaving me in the parking lot, wondering what my father did that he went to jail for 5 years. I couldn't sleep that night. First off, I had been tricked by Trina. Secondly, the thing her father had said about my father was bothering me. Why did Trina's father share that piece of information about my father? I decided not to ask my father about it since he may not tell me the truth. I decided to investigate it myself. The next few days, I kept my distance from my dad. I told him I had exams coming up and I wanted to be ready. This was the only way to get him off my back and not be suspicious as to why I was keeping my distance. I filled out an application online so that I would be able to obtain my father's criminal record. Since my dad is the only one that could apply, I had to forge his signature and the papers I needed. I checked the mailbox religiously because the package would be delivered with my dad's name on it. I had to get to it before he did. A month later, the package finally arrived. I ran up to my room and opened it. At that moment, I realized that I made a grave mistake, and I should have let sleeping dogs lie. My father and some of his friends tried to rob a mini-mart a few weeks after he graduated college. They were able to exit the mart, but the owner ran after them with a firearm. One person was fatally injured that night. It was the getaway driver. Her name was Lorraine Jameson, my mother. I spent most of my childhood with my grandparents, and I just never questioned it. My dad told me that my mother died during childbirth. I was born the same night that the robbery took place. After spending 5 years in prison, he got out on parole for good behavior. After reading everything, I packed my clothes and grabbed my keys. I left the documents on the kitchen counter where my father could see them easily. I walked out of my father's house for the last time. What started out as clean fun ended up changing my entire life.